Hello and welcome. My name is Kevin, and in this video we are going to be looking at how we can use intersection observers to do this thing with the navigation where, you know, when you scroll down and it shifts from being like transparent to adding a background color to it or something else like that and back off. And we're going to be sort of pushing it a little bit, so we're going to be using intersection observer to do this because it's just more performant than using event listeners on scroll. But we're also going to be using CSS variables to make this really easy and fast switch between one state to the other. So you don't actually have to there's almost not much CSS that you have to write when it comes to the change state. CSS variables just make that so easy and awesome to do. So let's go and see how we can do that. Okay, so here we are in VS Code, and here we have already set some stuff up, and this starting file is linked down below. There's one to a GitHub repo that has this starting file, so if you want to follow along, and there is one to the finished files as well. So if you run into any trouble and you want to see the exact code I had, you can check out that. Now, what's happening now is we have this page that it looks, I think, pretty nice here at the top. Let's just make this a bit bigger so we can see what it would look like. So here's sort of where we'd have a logo, our main navigation, and this other little secondary navigation on the side there. And it looks really nice. We have a transparent background on it, but once we get to here, we can't read the text anymore, and that sucks. And it's nice to have these fixed navigations, but that switch when we get to a lower point, and intersection observer is really good to be able to do that. So what I've done is I've created some classes already. So if I come here and I do class is nav scrolled, and I save that, you're gonna see that we get the white background with the black text and everything like that. Just really, really fast, if we come and look at my SAS file here, really, really fast, you can see I'm auto refreshing when I save. If you do use my GitHub repo, there's a README there that has really basic instructions on how to use it. I'm using gulp to auto refresh and compile my SAS. So there is a little bit of SAS, but what I've done is I've created some custom properties here. And the reason that custom properties are really, really nice for something like this is I'm changing colors in a bunch of places at once, but I only have to worry about this and not all the different places that it's actually changing. Now, if you don't know about custom properties, I do have a little mini series. There should be a card popping up for that now. But in that series and in most tutorials you see on custom properties, they are put on the root instead of inside of an actual component like I'm doing here in my header. The reason I'm doing it in my header is because I'm sort of isolating these colors and these, like the text inverse and background, are for this header only, and I wouldn't be using them outside of that. If it's something where you're using the colors throughout your entire site, this doesn't make much sense. But since for this really basic demo, I'm self-contained colors pretty much, I've put them in the header, and I think that you can use them well in that way. And that means anything inside my header does inherit these. So that's what I'm actually using on my button. When I'm hovering on that, I'm using my text inverse for the text color there, and the same thing here on this button. So if we go and look, I'm using it here. So you can see I've set my background color to background and my color to text. But if we scroll further down here, you will find here I have my hover where I'm switching it. So my background has become my text color, my color has become my text inverse, and I'm just making sure that my border matches it so it works properly. So my background and my border color stay the same. And here on my highlight, which is this one here, I have like sort of the default styling, but then I'm going back to those variables for when I hover on top. And you're going to see those are all going to sort of switch around after. So what I've done is when we have that nav scrolled class that comes in, I don't have to go through and find my hover here and find my highlight hover and go and find the other thing. All I'm doing is switching these things here. So I'm just switching those three variables. And that means when that class does get put on here, let's go put it back on, all the colors throughout all that are switching. So my hover color gets switched over to black on that. It's switched over to black on this one. My background is switched. All of that is happening just by changing this. So super, super handy and a nice use for custom properties. I've just put a little drop shadow on this too to make it stand out a little bit more. So the real magic of this one is going to be getting it to switch when we scroll up and down. And it's not that hard to do, but we just need to add or remove that class. But we don't want to do it with a scroll event listener because that means the whole time we're scrolling up and down, we're just firing off things like crazy. Whereas we could just listen for one very specific situation to happen and have it switch in that. And that's what intersection observer is really, really good for. Now I'm going to be going a little bit, I'm not going to be spending a lot of time looking at exactly how we're building this out, because I've looked at the basics of Intersection Observer already in another video. If you've already watched that, you're ready to go. If you haven't watched it, it might be a good idea to go check it out. If you want to try and follow along with this one, maybe it'd be perfect and you'd be able to follow along no problem. But if ever I go gloss over something and you're not sure what I was doing or why I did that, go and check out the original video. The link for it is in the description below. And with that, you'll get a better idea of how and why I'm writing all of these things. And then just because in this one, I'm just focused on like this specific situation and not on the general happenings or the general behavior of an intersection observer. So we're going to start off by creating a couple of things that we need to keep track of. So one of them is my header itself, because we need to change the class on that. So document query selector. And we want to look at my header. And the second one that we want to watch for, const, I'm going to call it section one. And that will be my document query selector. And in this case, I called it home intro. And the home intro is this here, this dark background that we're looking at. So what we want to do is we're going to be listening, like, when is this leaving the screen? And when it leaves the screen, we want to change the background on that. And then when it comes back into the screen, we want the background to change again on it. So we need, this is what we're going to be watching, and then this is what we're going to be changing the class on. So with those set up, let's come and create our observer itself. So we're going to do const. Now in the original tutorial, this I just did observer. I'm going to call this one section one observer. Because that's what we're looking at. And because once we get through all the different parts of this, we're going to have a bunch of different observers going on for this one. So we can't just call it observer, but it will still be a new intersection observer. And let's go and make this bigger just for now. And I'll shrink it back down after once we start getting some stuff, because on our intersection observer, we need a few different things. One of them is going to be a function. So we can say function like that, open and close. And the second thing we are going to need is the options. So we have the two of those coming in. Now the options, I'm also going to change the name of it instead of just being options. Let's say section one options, just so we can keep track of it. And so we don't run into any errors. I'm going to create that right away. Section one options is equal to, and I'm just going to leave it blank for the moment, but we'll come through and actually add some stuff in there a little bit after. So here in our function, we also need to come in and watch for our entries. And I'm also going to put the observer in here, even though I'm not sure we're going to need it in this case, because we're not going to on observe anything, but we'll throw it in there as a precaution. All right, cool. So we have our new intersection observer doing a function. It's going to be looking at the entries and add itself. And then we're also going to be bringing in these options that are up there. And right here, we can start our actual function. So I'm just going to hit save on that. You can see it reposition things a little bit. That's just prettier. That's organizing this to try and make it a little bit more readable. So here in my function, what we're going to do is we want my entries. And for each, if you watch the other video, you know what we're going to do here. Each entry, now we'll use an arrow function. And we can say that, let's start off by doing a console log to make sure that this is actually working. So entry target, because I always like checking along the way instead of running into a problem after like everything else that I've done. So we can do our section one observer needs to observe, and we want it to observe section one. So let's save that. So let's shrink this back down because I don't think we need it so big anymore. And there we go. We can see that it fired off right when the page loaded in there. So perfect. It is actually working. So let's delete this console log because we won't really be needing it since we know it is working. In this case, what do we want to do? So let's think about this for a second. When I scroll down, when this leaves the page, I want it the nav class to come in. So let's look for one thing at the beginning. So we're going to say if if entry is intersecting, and again, if you're not sure why this is going to work, please do check out the original video that I did, where what the whole is intersecting thing and other stuff along the way. So if my entry is intersecting with the page, we don't want to have that nav class is scrolled on here, right? So if like, say we scroll down and it adds it, if we come back up, we want to remove it. So if entry isn't, actually, let's start off with if the entry isn't intersecting. So if it's not intersecting with the page, we want to add that class on there, right? So we can say if it isn't intersecting, we can do our header class list add and add nav scrolled to it. So if we save that, it should, when we go down far enough, add that. There we go. So look at that. The class just came on. And if I go back up, well, it doesn't leave now, though. So that's a bit of a problem. So let's refresh that again and just watch it one more time. So when I scroll down, there we go. It clicks on and we see it. Okay, so that's cool. So now we could write this straight in as just like an else statement. So if it isn't intersecting, we can do that. Else, we could say that header class list remove nav scrolled. Now, this will mean it's going to try, so when it is intersecting, like right now, it'll try and remove it. The class isn't there. I don't think that's a big of an issue though, but if you wanted to, you could make this an else if statement and say like, if it is intersecting and if the class list contains nav scrolled to remove it. But now it should work, where when I scroll down, it adds it. And then when it comes back into the screen, it removes it. So we can see, just like that, it's going back and forth and it is working. I do have a transition on the background, so you can see it's like it sort of transitions in and out. It's hard to see on the white, but it is transitioning in and out. But the one thing that's a little bit annoying is we lose what we're looking at here, right? At one point, this is still intersecting with the screen, so it hasn't come in yet. So this is where we can use our section one options here, and I can set the root margin. So if I set the root margin, it works just like the regular one, and I want to work off the top of the page. So it can be a percentage or pixel value, so we'll stick with pixels. So we'll say -200 from the top of the page, and then we'll just do 0 for the rest of them. And you have to put 0 pixels, it can't just be 0. And so now, you can see, it's even though I can see this, it's actually white now. And once I scroll to a certain point, so it's once this is within, and I put -200 because I'm pushing it downwards by 200 pixels. So the way it's working now is it's going down 200 pixels. So it's not when it intersects the viewport, it's when it intersects 200 pixels away from the top of the viewport. So now when I get to there, it's switching back and forth. So we're sort of preemptively switching it before we can't read the text, which just makes it a little bit easier to read. And you can see the transition a lot nicer when that switches back and forth now too. And of course you can play with that number and everything, but you can't use viewport units on that. You do have to use pixels or percentages for the root margin. That was fun, wasn't it? I had a lot of fun doing that. I hope you had fun watching it, and I hope you learned a few things along the way as well. If you did, please let me know in the comments, or if you think of other ways you could be able to use this maybe, or other ways or approaches you could do, please leave a comment down below and let me know. Love to have a bit of a discussion about it. But if you really want to have an in-depth discussion, I'd encourage coming over to the community. My community is a free Discord channel. You can just go down in the description below, find the link, click on it, and you're in. There's literally no other steps. It's super, super easy to do. There's a whole bunch of people in there. We're having lots of fun and cool discussions. And if you have questions or run into problems, it's a lot easier to ask there and find out stuff there and just also meet people along the way than it is in the YouTube comments down below. So I look forward to seeing you there in the community. Big thank you for watching all of this. A double big super thank you to my patrons for helping support everything I do here on my channel. Thank you once again for watching. Next week, we're going to be looking at another thing you can do with intersection observers. So please come and check that one out too. It's going to be those slidey images. No, when you're scrolling down and things either like fade in or they just appear. So if you haven't yet subscribed, hit that subscribe button so you see that video when it comes out. Because you don't want to miss that. It's going to be pretty cool too. But until then, of course, don't forget to make your corner of the internet just a little bit more awesome.